Sunday morning at 11 a.m., we'll be presenting a message for a Memorial Day weekend, and we believe that it is very important for us to recognize the occasion for which this time has been set aside. It's not just about picnics and families together, even though that's been quite a challenge this year, but it is about the true meaning of Memorial Day. But for this morning in our worship time, we want to lead you in a celebration of Memorial Day, and we're going to ask you, if you're joining us through Facebook and YouTube, in your homes, wherever you may be, to stand and join with us in the Pledge of Allegiance and then the singing of the National Anthem. Would you stand with us at this time? Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which kingdom stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So proudly we hail at the twilight.
blessed America. Amen. We welcome you this morning as we worship together, and we are so honored that you've chosen to join us this morning through the ministry of Facebook and YouTube, and we are looking forward once again to the time when we will get back together as a church family. But until that time comes, we are honored that we're able to come to you if you're not able to be with us. And so the Spirit of the Lord is not limited in His presence. He can be where you are just as He is where we are. We so appreciate our worship team this morning and leading us in our patriotic celebration. And in just a moment, they're going to share another song with you. But for this moment, we're going to continue in the scripture that we began last week from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, in what has been commonly known as the story of the prodigal son. Today, we'll begin reading at verse 17. Would you stand as we honor the reading of God's word? And when he came to himself, he said, "How many hired servants of my father have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. No more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants." And he arose and came to his father. But he was yet a great way off. His father saw him and had compassion, and ran, and fell on his neck, and kissed him. The son said unto him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son." But the father said to his servants, "Bring forth the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." And they began to be merry. Our Father, we bow this morning with grateful heart, thanking you that we have the privilege of knowing Jesus Christ as our Savior. But at the same time, we're burdened because we know there are those who do not know him. And in many cases, that's a matter of their personal choice. And so we're praying this morning that God will use every part and every person in this service through the power of your Spirit to speak to someone and bring them to the realization that life can be better than it ever has been, better than they ever thought it could be, the moment they give their heart to Jesus Christ and trust him as their Savior. We give you all the praise now for what you're going to do. In Jesus' loving name, amen. As the sanctuary choir sings, "Blades of Grass and Pure White Stones," you will be watching the video on the overhead.
Blades of grass and pure
How painful it was last week as we watched a young man go on a journey that basically was the road to ruin. A young man who had so much promise, and it just seemed like he wasted it all. He made a series of bad decisions, and most people who wind up on the road to ruin don't do it because they made one bad choice. It's because they made a number of them, and they seem to have a way of compounding one another. You recall that the young man reached the point where when his money ran out, his friends did also. And he reached the point where he was given a job that was one of the most despicable jobs any Jewish boy could have. And that was feeding pigs. And he's not going to complain because that's all he can get. As a matter of fact, when we last talked with him, when we last saw him, he was willing to eat the pods that he was supposed to be feeding to the pigs. That's how bad life had gotten for him. And I'll tell you how bad it really had gotten. The last verse says, "And no man gave unto him." If there was ever such a thing as a young man hitting rock bottom, he did it. And you have to wonder, why did God allow that anyway? Why did God just not intervene at some point along the way? You have to understand, there is what we know as God's permissive will. He created us as free moral agents. He didn't create us robots. He didn't force us to do anything against our will. He gave us the choice, he gave us the options, and he trusted us to use good judgment and make the best choices. And apparently this man did not do that. And things can't really get any worse. Well, you think they always can, but it would be hard to imagine how anything could possibly get any worse than they had for this young man. He's come to the end of himself, and you can see how he is just withered into a pile of misery. And for the first time in a long time, if not the first time in his life, he does something that every person who wants to turn their life around must do. And so while last week we were following a young man on the road to ruin, we want now to join him on the road to rejoicing. And I could probably say it was the road to recovery, but it's much more than that. This is a road to rejoicing. And I'm saying to anyone this morning who is on the road to ruin, you can turn it around and you can take these steps, and they are steps. You will get there, not in a moment's time, because when you went down that slippery slope of ruin, you didn't get there overnight. And so when you turn it around, you're not going to get back to where you want to be or need to be overnight. It's a process that you work through. But each step takes you a little bit higher, a little bit closer to your intended goal. And you'll get there, no doubt about it. Be patient, keep going, keep trying, keep trusting, and you'll get there. And so the first thing that this young man had is what every person who wants to get on the road to rejoicing must have. He had a time of reasoning. The scripture says, and when he came to himself, that I guarantee he never had a serious conversation with him for a long time, if he ever had a conversation with himself. Pastor, it's not good to talk to yourself. Yes, it is too. Sometimes you need to talk to yourself. Just don't argue with yourself. That's when you get into the problem. Make no mistake about it. This young man came to that point where he just realized, this is not working. This is not working. This is not good. And for the first time in a long time, he used sound judgment. Listen, make no mistake about it. For the first time in a long time, I would be willing to say the words of his father were ringing true in his ears. For the first time in a long time, he is just using basic common sense. At least he has that much. Everybody has that much. And you got to know that where you are now, it's not working. It is not good. You've got to do something, and you've got to do it soon, and you've got to do it yourself. And so if you want to get back on the road to rejoicing, you can do that. But you've got to have a time of reasoning. Sit down and have a serious conversation with yourself. Look at what's happening. Look at your life. Are you really happy about that? You really satisfied? Is this what you want? Is this the real you? Is this how you want to be known? Is this how you want to be remembered? Listen, get it together. Take that time. Not only that, but he not only had a time of reasoning, he also had a time of reality. And here is the reality. He starts thinking about, and why not? What else would he think about at this point? He starts thinking about life back home. He starts thinking about the very life that he said one day, I've had enough of this, I'm out of here, I'm done with it. All of a sudden, that life back home doesn't look that bad. And not surprising, the first thing that's mentioned that he remembers when he thinks about life back home is food, 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 oh, food. He said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough to eat? And I'm starving. How about that? Some of you grew up on a farm. You remember the day when hired hands would come. It was the responsibility of the owner of the farm to feed them. And boy, and they didn't give them a sandwich either. Not back then, not that time. They gave them a full meal. And I can just imagine that young man thinking about life back home. And just seeing all of those servants, not to mention his own family, what's going on there. I could just see in his mind that table. Pastor, you would talk about food, wouldn't you? Yes, I would. That he would see that long table with all those people sitting around it. But he's not worried about the people sitting around the table. He's thinking about what's on the table. And guess what? That roast beef, mashed potatoes, gravy, corn on the cob, hot biscuits, oh man, and here I am eating a stinking piece of cob that I was supposed to be feeding to the pigs. Not only that, but he saw those pies, that coconut cream pie and that apple pie over on the stand, over on the dresser right there. And here I am, my father's servants have it better than I have it. Life wasn't all that bad, was it? Let me tell you, a little word right here for our young people. You're about to graduate, and some of you already have. And my graduation speech every year is basically the same. It's very short. You've got your diploma. Now you're going to get an education. And I want to tell you something. Young people, listen up. Get up on the edge of your chair, because I want you to hear this, and I want you to remember this. Get out there and enjoy life while you know everything. Because there is going to come a time, and it won't be long about it, when you realize your parents and your friends, your older friends, were a lot smarter than you thought they were. I'm telling you this, the older you get, the wiser they will be. You will understand. Young people, I'm telling you, you think life is that bad at home? You think that it's cruel and unusual punishment because your parents insist on you doing something that is by any definition reasonable? Let me tell you, one day you will realize life wasn't that bad. And it won't be long. This young man realized life back home. I wonder how many times he felt like, boy, I'm out of here. I've had enough of this. I'm not listening to this anymore. I'm not taking this anymore. I don't have to take it. No, you don't. But one day you'll realize, and you've got to come to the realization that the life that you are living is not the life the Lord wants you to have. And the next thing you've got to understand is that you've got to make some resolution. And I'm not talking about the New Year's variety. I'm not talking about the kind that you make and you've forgotten them before the sun goes down. I'm talking about you absolutely make some decision. What did he say? I will arise. I will go. I will say, these things I will do. I'm going to make a resolution. I'm going to make some tough decisions here. I'm going to do something that I've never done in my life. I'm going to make a decision, and I'm going to follow through on it. I'm going to stay with it. I'm going to stand with it. I want to give you a definition this morning because it's absolutely essential. If you're going to get back on the road to rejoicing, you've got to know this. You've got to believe this. And don't ever forget this. The definition of insanity, you know what the definition of insanity is? It's doing the same thing you've always done and thinking different results. It's not going to happen. It is not going to happen. When you always do what you've always done, you'll always have what you always had. And so, unless and until you're ready to do something different, until you make that decision, until you make that resolution, I'm going to do this, I'm putting my mind to it, it's not some flippant notion, it's not something that come into my mind and it's gone out just as fast as it came in, I'm going to do this. I will go, and I will say, I will return. This morning, on the road to rejoicing, you've got to come to that place where you absolutely will make a resolution and stay with it. The next thing you have to know, the young man accepted responsibility. He said, I'm going back and I'm going to tell my father, Father, I have sinned against you and against heaven. To anyone who's on the road to ruin this morning, and there are plenty of people who are on the road to ruin. You absolutely are. And nothing's going to change until you change. Unless and until you accept full responsibility for where you are, for what you are, and for who you are, nothing is going to change. I don't mean to pass off negative information to you this morning, but I've got to tell you, you have to accept responsibility. That young man, I never heard a word out of him about, well, my parents were so tough on me. My parents were so unreasonable. And my brother, that elder brother, we'll talk about him maybe another time. But he was just relentless. He wouldn't leave me alone. He's on me all the time. And on it went. I didn't hear any of that. I didn't hear him blaming society. Oh, society owes me. Society is so cruel to me. I didn't hear him blaming circumstances. Well, my circumstances in life are different than your circumstances or anybody else's. I didn't hear any of that. And if you want to get on the road to rejoicing, I don't want to hear it from you either, because it's not going to work until you own it. You know what they say? You can't disown it until you own it. It's on you. It's on you. Don't be looking over your shoulder. Don't be looking at someone else. Don't be trying to pass the buck. This morning, you've got to accept responsibility for being who you are and where you are. To be sure, there may have been other things and other people who contributed to your downfall. You know, maybe it would have been different if his tightwad friends had stayed with him. Maybe things would have been different. But then in the providence of God, that wasn't what the Lord intended. And he would not have been here if they had bailed him out. Don't be, by the way, really want to see somebody get their life back on the road to rejoicing. You cannot be a partaker in their sins. You cannot aid and abet them in the life that they're doing. And sometimes it's tough. It's tough love. But you've got to take a strong stand. You've got to take a firm stand. And by the way, I just wonder, when that young man said, I'm going back and I'm going to tell my father, Father, I have sinned against you and against heaven. He was owning it. He was taking what he should have taken. But then I have to remember, when I read that scripture, no doubt that young man's father was a godly man. So, Pastor, of course he was. Later on, he was there watching. He was looking. But here's what I find very interesting. How did that young man come up with that statement? How did he figure that out? Where did this come from? When he said, I am going back and I'm going to tell my father, I have sinned against you and against heaven. I've got to believe that man's father was a godly man. And I've got to believe that young man's life being turned around was a direct result of a praying father. I've got to believe that that young man heard his father many times talk about the scriptures, talk about God, talk about sin. I'm going back and I'm going to tell my father, I have sinned against you and against heaven. Where did he get that from? Somebody had told him something. And so I just say to any parent today whose child is wayward, pray, pray, pray. Just keep on praying. Keep on teaching. Keep on believing. Maybe it'll happen. Maybe it won't. But at least you will know in your heart you did everything humanly and spiritually possible to get that person's life turned around. But in the final analysis, it's up to the individual to make that decision. That young man did what he said he would do. He went back and he told his father exactly what he said he was going to tell him. By the way, I think about this. I don't know how many miles he was from home. I don't know how many days it took him to get there. A far country doesn't really have to be that far when you're talking about your relationship to God. A far country doesn't have to be that far. There was a young man one day who told the Lord a lot of things, and the Lord told him, you're not far, but you're not in. You're close, but you're not in. And so a far country doesn't have to be that far away from the Lord. But you're not far, but you're not in. I don't know how long it took that young man to get home, but I guarantee all the way home, he rehearsed that speech. He said, I'm going back, and I'm going to tell my father, I have sinned against you, and I have sinned against heaven. All the way home, he's rehearsing this speech over and over again. And guess what? When he got home, he said exactly what he said he was going to do. Probably his mind was so programmed, he couldn't say anything else. Make no mistake about it. The man knew what he wanted to say. He knew what he had to admit. And he was not about to change his story simply because he saw his father waiting at the end of the road. Which, by the way, that could have been good news or it could have been bad news. When he got back and he saw his father standing and waiting, sometimes, I don't know about that. That might not be good news when you see him standing and waiting. But in this case, it was good news. It was very good news. And so, to you this morning, And whether we continue in this story will be how the Lord leads, we'll see. But to you this morning, who are on the road to ruin, and if you are, you know you are. And if you are, it's time for you to sit down and have a serious talk with yourself. It is time for you to be brutally honest. It is time for you to admit what you're doing is not working. It is time for you to say, maybe I ought to make a change in my life. Maybe somebody else knew exactly what they were talking about. Maybe I should take their advice. It is worth a try. It is at least worth a try. And maybe, just maybe, when you do that, you will find that, boy, I never knew life could be so fulfilling. I never knew there could be such rejoicing. And just so you know, we said last week, this story started by the Lord telling three stories. First about a lost sheep, second about a lost coin, and third about a lost son. The scripture says, concerning the lost sheep that was found, I want to tell you something. There is rejoicing in heaven over one that comes back. So this morning, if you are the prodigal, if you're in a far country, if you're on the road to ruin, and you want to touch off a celebration in heaven, all you've got to do is turn it around and come back. And by the way, the number one cheerleader that you will have this morning is none other than our Lord Jesus Christ. He will be leading the cheers. He will be jumping up and down in heaven. There's joy in heaven this morning. Who you think is joyful? None other than Jesus Christ. But I'm telling you, if you'll turn it around, come back. Come on home. Come on home. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Come on home. If you'll do that, you'll be rejoicing along with everybody else. And you'll be saying, I never knew life could be like this. And you probably will be asking somebody, why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you tell me? Well, we've been trying, you know, but you just wouldn't listen. You just couldn't hear. You knew it all, remember? You knew it all. But now, life has never been better. And this morning, I'm telling anyone who is on the road to ruin, you can turn it around, take these steps, and get back on the road to rejoicing. And there'll be a celebration in heaven, and you'll be celebrating with them, and we'll be joining in it with you. And so this morning, that's the invitation. Ask our worship leaders to come as we prepare for our invitation this morning. And that song of invitation this morning is At Calvary. We've come to just appreciate this song. It's a very powerful message in it. And as the worship team prepares, this is our invitation. You don't need me to tell you that in these last couple of months, there has been a real shortage of items in the grocery stores. We won't even mention toilet paper. We just don't even mention that this morning. Please, don't even talk about that this morning. But there are other items, too. And one that I have noticed, and I just find this rather interesting, bottled waters is in scarce supply. Which leads me to ask the question, and I'm just asking this very honestly, do houses not come with running water anymore? Has the well gone dry? Has the city cut off all the water? Yeah, Pastor, but that's not good. What's not good about it? Well, what you get at the store is spring water. Then I got another question for you. What spring did that water come out of? I've not seen a spring, and I've seen a number of my lifetime. I have not seen a spring that would produce enough water that you could load up a truck and with all these bottles and 5-gallon jugs or whatever else. Where'd that water come from? Which spring out of D.C. did it come out of? What I want to know. Listen, this morning, I've got news for you. If you're thirsty, there's a fountain of life. There's a river of water. Jesus Christ says, anybody who drink of this water will never thirst again. This morning, are you hungry? There's the bread of life. Are you thirsty? There's the water. If you eat the bread, you will never hunger. If you drink the water, you will never thirst. But we're talking about a spiritual hunger and a spiritual thirst. And when you get right down to it, that is exactly and precisely what every person has. This young man was looking. The last thing we said last week was he was searching. He really was. He was searching, but he did not know what he was looking for. Now he's going to find out. And this morning the invitation is, if you'll come to Jesus Christ, trust him as your Savior, you'll never thirst spiritually. You'll never hunger spiritually, because he is the bread of life. He is the fountain of water from which you can drink. And the scripture says in the last verses of the book of Revelation, let he that is athirst come. That's the invitation, the Lord's last word to you this morning as we sing at Calvary. Wherever you are, in your home, it does not matter. In your business, it does not matter. Wherever you are, Jesus Christ is right there, right now, asking you to come, drink the water, and eat the bread. As we stand, as we sing, would you listen? Thank you today for the cross of Calvary, for the price that Jesus Christ paid, for the gift that he gave, and for the peace that we have right now of knowing that There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And to know today that there is rejoicing in heaven over one who comes, more than over 100 unrighteous who refuse to hear. Thank you, Lord, today for letting us look at the example that has been set before us and apply this truth to our hearts. And may everyone who is on the road to ruin know they can take that step that will lead them to the road of rejoicing. In Jesus' name, amen. People said, I'm on the road to rejoicing.
I'm on the road to rejoicing.
Amen.